Now, the focus of today's webinar is about improvements in the IR hot gas expander as installed in the nitric acid plant. Our presenter today is Ash Maruyama. Ash joined Sulzer in 2007 as an engineer with a focus on rotor dynamic analysis. He has served as project engineer on numerous projects involving re-rates, redesign, failure analysis, and reverse engineering of steam turbines, centrifugal and axial compressors, screw compressors, and hot gas expanders. Now, we will be taking your questions following the presentation. To submit, if you just look to the right-hand side of your screen, you will see a section to submit your questions. And now, it is my pleasure to introduce you to Ash Maruyama.
Good morning, everyone. Like I said, my name is Ash Maruyama with Sulzer. I've also invited Mark Bounds to join me in this presentation. He's our superintendent of our core division. He has extensive knowledge with these hot gas expanders. He's been with Sulzer for 29 years now, so I welcome him to join me in helping me make this presentation. He'll be able to answer a lot of the questions as far as operations goes and as far as details on some of these repairs. So with that, we'll get right into it. So as we said, today we're going to be talking about improvements that we offer specifically on the IR hot gas expander installed in nitric acid plants. And just so a brief overview for the presentation that we're going to go over today, we'll discuss really quickly the expander fleet map of how we see it in a nitric acid plant. We'll go through the anatomy of the IR expander specifically, and then we'll discuss the improvements that we offer. So as far as the nitric acid plants goes and all the machines that we've seen come in from those plants, we've kind of put together a pictogram that shows the population breakdown for the different types of expanders. The IR expander is not the only one out there. However, it is the most popular one that we see out there. There's four different frame sizes that fit within this classification, ranging from the E516, the smallest one, all the way up to the 526, which is the largest one. Together, they form this family of E-series expanders. Population, we're putting it somewhere north of 100. Now, there are other expanders that exist in nitric acid plants. The Worthington family is another one. It's not as popular. We do see these in our shop as well, though, so we added that onto our list. And then finally, at the end, the one that we see not as often as the rest, but we still have experience with is a BVC expander. And so you can just kind of see the breakdown of the tons per day, the flow rate that is going through these machines. And just to give you an example, sorry about that. So this just kind of shows the breakdown, where all the machines fit, and then why we're focusing on the IR expander, because it is the most popular, it is the one that we have the most experience with, and the one that we've done a lot of upgrades on. So with that, let's step right into it. Just a quick overview of the anatomy of how an expander actually works. So an expander pretty much works the same as a steam turbine or the turbine section of a gas turbine. It runs off of a hot gas that expands across rotating blades to create power. So the inlet for this machine is at the top here. It comes into an inlet scroll. Now the scroll's job is to disperse the flow evenly around the circumference of the rotor. From there, the hot gas will expand across the rotating elements, creating power, and then finally it will exhaust out the back end and down through the exhaust on the bottom. So this is the same for all E-series expanders. This is how the flow pattern works. As far as inlet conditions and exhaust conditions and power and whatnot, just to show you a breakdown of the various sizes and how they fit with each other, you can see that the inlet conditions, they're all fairly about the same. So they all take about the same pressure. Notice that it's not extremely high pressure like you would see on a steam turbine. It's more akin to a gas turbine in pressure, but the temperatures are nowhere near what a gas turbine would see. It's closer to a steam turbine. So it's kind of an amalgamation between the two. The power output and shaft speed, you can kind of see where the ranges are and where they fit. And then finally, all of them are going to exhaust the atmosphere at a temperature between 5 to 600. So before we go any further, we need to talk about some nomenclature, so that way we're all on the same page as to how I'm referring to all these things. So to start off with, very simply, the outer case I'm also listing materials there that we commonly find that these parts are made out of. So the case is kind of unique. It has a horizontal split line, but you can also see here the top half contains a vertical split line as well. So a little bit unique, but it's necessary for the assembly of this machine. The internal casing is formed of three components, the inlet scroll, which is here, the HP stator housing, and then the LP stator housing. After that, the rotor, we'll go more in depth on the stationary and rotating components. For now, this is just a general breakdown of the major components that you can see. The process seals, so there are two main process seals on this, the high pressure and the low pressure. They both use honeycomb seals. And then the bearing housing on the end. So your thrust is on the HP side, and this is true for all the machines, that it does not vary. So we'll dive into the rotor now. So the rotor breakdown, this is very similar to how a gas turbine is built, held together by a single through bolt. So this is actually an assembled rotor. It's not an integral type rotor. The disc and the heavy wall sleeve, this being the heavy wall sleeve, they use curvet couplings between each disc for the connections. These curvet teeth are designed to allow for self-centering when these discs grow during operation. And then finally, we'll discuss this more in depth as well, but this rotor is actually hollow, like many gas turbines. It uses internal cooling passages to cool the discs. However, there is no internal cooling passages for the blades. The blades are only externally cooled by the air. There is no internal cooling in these blades. Just the main job for the cooling air is to keep the through bolt cool, so that way you don't lose the bundle crush. So as far as the nomenclature goes, this rotor consists of an HP stub, a heavy wall sleeve, and of course our discs. And interesting to note that these discs can either be out of A286 or 422. It actually depends on the machine that we're looking at. Some machines use 422 throughout all the discs. Some machines use A286 throughout all the discs. Some have a combination of the two materials. So it all depends on the type of application that this machine is being used for. The LP stub. And then our through bolt, as you can see, we have a choice of materials, 422 or 450. We'll go over that later in the presentation. And our through bolt nut, which helps was responsible for creating the bundle crush. Our cooling sleeves, we'll also discuss this a little bit more in depth. They just allow a space between the through bolt and the disc to allow for cooling air to flow down in between the through bolt and these cooling sleeves. And last but not least, our rotating blade. So as far as our stationary components go, we already mentioned this, but we have our inlet scroll. It's made out of 347, and it's actually made through a process called spin forging. Very unique process. This is so that way the scroll can grow evenly in the radial direction. Our nozzle, this will be our inlet nozzle. This is responsible for creating the airflow, turning it from a circular pattern into an actual axial flow. That will be the entrance into our rotor and gas path. Our stationary housings, HP and LP, you can see that they're all rabbit fitted together. Interestingly enough, the stationary components, there's really only two contact points with the case, and that's here with the LP stator housing, and then the scroll makes contact with the case as well. So all this is kind of held together by like a large jigsaw puzzle. So when you build these things, it's really important to keep in mind that whatever you do to one fit or another fit, you have to make sure that it's going to affect everything else and that it won't push anything out of tolerance. Our stator segments, you can see it's pretty self-explanatory. We'll go over a little bit more on some of the improvements we've made on those stator segments. Our HP seal housing, and this HP seal housing actually entails three pieces. There's an outer housing, and then there's an HP seal insert, which is shown here in this light red pattern, and then finally the honeycombs in this gray right here. So So the honeycombs actually get brazed into this this seal insert, which then gets attached to the seal housing. As you can see here, the breakdown. Now on the LP side, there is no honeycomb insert. Instead, the honeycomb is brazed directly to the seal housing itself. So I said we'd go a little bit more in depth on the sealing cooling scheme, and so this is a little complicated, but it's essential to understand how this works, to understand how this rotor is supposed to operate. So the cooling air actually comes from the second body discharge of this compressor train that this expander is attached to. So keep in mind that your gas path is up here, your flow is up here, so keep that in mind as we talk about this, this cooling air scheme. So I've added a port here because I don't want to confuse you too much, but there is actually a port on the case. This is where the cooling air will enter into the case itself and fill this cavity here. From here, there's actually a hole that we drill into the HP seal housing. This allows us to feed these cooling air channels. So this is just one of many that are drilled around the circumference of the seal housing. Now, to prevent the cooling air from actually backing out this way, we install a plug in this route. So the cooling air actually takes this path. So it will enter in, fill this chamber, travel around circumferentially, and be admitted into all the cooling air ports. Will flow down and reach this chamber here. So from there, the cooling air travels in the area in between the rotating labyrinth and the honeycomb sealing material. The cooling air can go both ways. It's obviously going to have to be at a higher pressure than it is in the inlet here. This is how it seals this chamber off from the gas. So the gas will not leak back this way. Instead, cooling air will leak in this direction into the gas path. Cooling air also has an opportunity to go this way, and we'll discuss a little bit more in depth about that in a minute. So additionally, there are holes in this HP stub. This allows the cooling air to transfer inside the rotor itself. We'll fill this chamber inside, and you can see there are actually holes in the cooling sleeve. This allows the air to get trapped in between the sleeve and the through bolt itself. So from there, the cooling air will actually be able to flow down the length of the through bolt and will blow out in between each one of these cooling sleeves through holes and in between each disc. And the cooling air will then rejoin the stream through the curvet teeth, through the seals, and back into the cooling stream. So this is how we provide internal cooling to the through bolt and to the rest of the rotor as well as are able to provide a good seal for the gas path itself. So now that we discuss pretty much how the expander works in general, we'll go through our improvements on how what we've done. So a couple of things to keep in mind that we'll discuss, HP brush seal packing. We'll go more in depth onto why we came up with this modification. We've also changed the through bolt material, any bearing upgrades that we've made as well, spool alignment, the upgrades that we've done. We've also made some modifications to the spool construction itself as far as thickness goes. We've also had a chance to work with some casting vendors to actually cast an entire case itself. So we offer that as this robust casing option to customers that require a brand new case or in fact a brand new spare machine. We've also done a one-piece inlet nozzle. Cast air segments are along the same vein as that. We also offer blade material upgrades, as well as instrumentation for monitoring. So we'll go through each one of these in depth. So for our HP seal, recall that since we just went over the cooling air scheme, recall that the cooling air entered the seal housing and flowed down in this manner. So from this point, the cooling air has an option that can go both ways. It can leak into the gas path over here, or it can travel down the length of the rotor body this way and provide cooling air for the rest of the rotor body. Now, the question becomes, what happens when you get here? If you have an excess of cooling air, which is common, it will leak out of the case, and it can take one of many directions. The most common path is going to be straight across your three labyrinth teeth here and into the atmosphere itself. Now, the only problem with that, though, is that if you keep going this way, you're going to run into a dangerous scenario. Your bearing housing is sitting right here, and with all this hot gas coming out, you have a tendency to burn up your wires for your RTDs or your displacement probes, as well as it creates a hazard for any personnel in the area as you do have this hot gas escaping straight out of the atmosphere. So on some cases that are designed with a heavier wall, what they've done is they've added this path in the case. And this allows for the cooling air, it's a vent port for the cooling air, for any excess cooling air to bleed off. So how this works is that we'll send cooling air into this chamber through a port in the seal insert. There is a port that is drilled on the case and in the housing itself. These two line up, so I'll show you the case port right here. This is the vent port for the excess cooling air, and this is drilled, it's cross-drilled to a port that leads to the outside. So from here, you can actually hook up a pipe, and you can either take this to the exhaust, or you can vent it straight to the atmosphere. It doesn't matter too much. The machine doesn't care all that much. The only problem with going to the atmosphere, though, is that sometimes, depending on where you situate the pipe, there may not be enough flow to actually warrant the air to go in that direction. Instead, the air will try and take the easier path out and go straight across these fields here, rather than trying to leave through this port. If you're venting to the exhaust flow itself actually helps to draw the cooling air out, and so that's not really an issue. So really we're focusing on the issue of if you don't have this vent port, or if you're venting, if you have this vent port tied to the atmosphere. So to come up with a solution for our customers, to offer a solution, we offer an HB brush seal packing. And so what we do is we'll install a brush seal here. And depending on the rotor, we may need to machine one of the labyrinth teeth off here to make room for this brush seal. But the brush seal will provide a much better seal than the labyrinth seal will there. So the idea is to stop the leakage going this direction. Therefore, we reduce the amount of leaks that flows out and reduce the hazards of either burning up your probe wires or personnel safety as well. And instead, we're trying to force the air to go through the vent port itself. So if you're trying to vent to the atmosphere and you don't have sufficient flow, hopefully the idea behind this is to stop the airflow and make it want preferentially go this direction and leave the case. So to give you a better view, I know that was a little confusing to look at in a 2D view. So in a 3D view, so here's our brush seal. These are your cooling hole ports, so the air is supplied in and travels on the length. So this port here is tied to your cooling ports, and this is your vent port through the HP seal housing. And you can see it's connected to this small port here, which is connected through to this area. This is the port that lines up with the case vent port. Another option that we offer our customers is a 3-volt material upgrade. So we found in the past that there are, these 3-volts were originally made out of 422. And what we're trying to do is increase the amount of crush that we can get. So what we did was we went from a 422 to a custom 450. Now the reason we went to this to get greater bundle crush out of this is the fact of this stretch. We've had instances in the past where the customer has lost cooling airflow to the through-bolt itself, so the through-bolt actually heats up to a temperature that was not expected. So the through-bolt will grow, you'll lose your crush on your bundle, and bad things can happen from there. So by having a greater crush, initial crush on the bundle using the custom 450, we can, if the customer loses a little bit of cooling air, it's not as detrimental. The rotor should be able to still function properly. And the other advantage of the custom 450 is that the custom 450 has a higher yield strength, and so this through bolt is going through multiple stacking and unstacking cycles during repair. A through-bolt will be able to survive longer than a 422 through-bolt will, simply because you're farther away from the dew point. You're under less cycles for low cycle fatigue. We also offer bearing upgrades for our customers. Initially, the design for these bearings was a spherical seated sleeve bearing. So you can see here there is a spherical seat for the case fit, and this utilized a plain sleeve bearing or sleeve bearing derivative. You can see this little pocket here for the oil. Now, this worked well up until the point when these machines started increasing in speed. When they started to increase the speed, they found that they would some of these machines were susceptible to oil whirl. The instability caused by the design of the sleeve bearing itself, it's just an inherent instability. You will reach a certain threshold of instability with the sleeve bearing type. The oil will start to whirl around with the shaft, and it will actually drive a synchronous instability. So to solve that, the first step that we took was to go from a sleeve type bearing to a tilt pad bearing. So we still had a spherical seat, but we changed to a five pad tilt pad bearing. Now, this was great. It worked. The problem that we found that occurred was that since the tilt pads, we used a ball and socket type pivot, the pads could self-align to any misalignment in the shaft. But then the bearing housing could also self-align. So when you had two things self-aligning, we found that what happened was that the shaft would actually start to ride on the oil field, causing it to delay. So that was not good. So to solve that issue, what we offer our customers now is a cylindrically seated tilt pad bearing. So this has resolved any instability issues that we faced in the past. And so this is what we now recommend for all of our customers if they are still running either one of these two derivatives. We also, in the process of repairing these machines, we've come up with ways to make our build and our assembly easier and more exacting, since these machines are highly susceptible, as you saw, to any misalignment, any changes in one part lead to changes in another part. So assembling these machines properly is very important. And so this is one of the upgrades that we came up with to help with our scroll alignment. So we created this hardened plate with an integral key to go where the normal keyway went. Because normally when we would do repairs and we're trying to align the scroll with the rest of the rotor and everything, we would be welding up the keyway and then trying to get our scroll aligned. And then once we got it aligned, we'd have to pull everything out, machine the keyway, put everything back together and see if it's still lined up. If something moved in the bundle, if you mismachine slightly, then your keyway's off, and then you'd have to start all over. You have to reweld your keyway up and then start the whole process over again. So to stop that, we came up with this hardened plate, so we'll machine the area where the key was flat. We'll install this hardened plate with the integral key. We'll do all of our alignment with the key float, with this whole plate free to move. Once we get everything set in place, we can pull the assembly off, and then we weld this plate in place. We'll weld this plate in place, and so that way it allows for much better precision alignment of our scroll and all the internal components, really, since all this has to be done at once. And also, the hardened plate allows for a much smoother friction surface, so when this scroll tries to grow under thermal cycles, it will face less friction and will allow to grow more freely. Now, over the past several years of doing this, we see a lot of scrolls that come in damaged. A lot of times the walls are collapsed in, especially around where the scroll pins go through the case. The scroll likes to hang up on those pins just over time due to the heat cycles, and that will cause the scroll to collapse on itself as it tries to grow out. The pins will hang up and consequently push the lugs into the wall. So what we've done is we've actually increased the wall thickness from about 1/8 inch to 1/4 inch to increase the scroll life. So far, we've only done this modification on E516s. In fact, most of the E516s that we have serviced in the past are now running this quarter-inch wall thickness with great success. So as you can see, the scrolls look identical. It's hard to tell if the wall thickness is any greater, but we've had good results with increased wall thickness. We've had several come back that were in much better condition than what a thinner wall scroll would come back in. So we offer that as an upgrade. Along those same lines, there's been some customers of ours that have had issues with case distortion, very drastic case distortion. So what we've done is when we were asked to design or supply a new case and a new spare machine, complete machine, at that time we elected to increase flange and wall thicknesses in certain locations by almost 50 to 70% in an effort to reduce the case distortion. And this helps, and we've had good success with this, so that you can see here's a standard case. You can look at the slip line thickness, and this is a robust case design. You can see a much, much thicker split line. This is to help with reducing the distortion that you face over time. Because these cases, because these machines are subject to numerous thermal cycles throughout their service life, the customers will have to shut down their machine before gauze change out, usually every 90 days or so. So this machine is seeing a lot of thermal cycles up and down, heating and shrinking. It will cause distortion over time just naturally. The robust cases that we've manufactured, when they've come back, they require very little cleanup along the split line area. So we've seen a drastic improvement in the amount of distortion reduction. So for the nozzles, originally these nozzles were fabricated, meaning that they were actually assembled, they were welded. So they just had blades physically welded to an outer ring. So this was the inlet into the gas path. And the important feature for a nozzle is going to be the throat dimension, maintaining that uniform throat dimension throughout all these nozzles is paramount to getting a good even flow around the rotor. Although it's a little hard to maintain that precision and accuracy when you're trying to weld metal in place. So now with the advent of technology, we can make a fully integral one-piece inlet nozzle using our CNC 5-axis mill. So this helps to greatly increase our dimensional control over that third dimension. Along those same lines for our stator segments, the same dimensional tolerancing applies, especially for that throat control. That is what's going to determine the amount of flow and where your choke point is in this machine. So in an effort to increase efficiency and dimensional control, original stator segments were made similar to the nozzle. They had airfoils that were welded to an inner and outer ring. But now we've taken the time to invest in casting. So these are investment cast stator segments. So now they're fully integral, one piece, much greater dimensional control, and it also makes it a little bit easier for us to manufacture these things. Now, we also offer blade material upgrades for our customers. Now, typically, your typical machine has your first two stages made out of A286, your last three stages are made out of 422. That's a typical setup. Like, as I said earlier, sometimes the first two stages, all five stages are made out of 422. Those are only for low temperature machines. Some of the other higher temperature machines use A286 all the way across. But the interesting part happens when you have this combination of materials. So we recommend, on some customers, we'll recommend switching to all A286. One, for blade life extension, although the temperature really doesn't warrant that the blade's going to expire based on life extension, like gas turbine blades will. The temperature simply isn't high enough, although it is getting close to the temperature limit of A286. But really what we're looking to do is reuse some of the blades during repairs. A lot of times when these machines come in, what will happen is we'll find tip rubs on these blades where the blade will make contact with the stator housing, and rubbing and causing an increased clearance. So to solve that increased clearance issue, what we'll do is we'll actually take the last four rows and move them upstream. We can do this because it turns out that all five stages of blades utilize the same profile. Even though there's a twist to the blade, it's just a crop down version of each blade. So really when we do this, we only have to make a stage five blade, and then we can just crop each blade to meet the road, to meet the stage that it needs to be. So with the example of tip rubs, because now you have an increased clearance on, say, the original stage, say stage two, you can shift the stage two blade to stage one, remachine the top, and reclaim the original clearance. And in this manner, you just have to make one row blade, stage five row. If you had that mixed match of blades, what happens is that you'd actually end up having to make two rows of blades rather than one, because we do not recommend installing a 286 blade into a 422 disc. The thermal growth difference between the two is too great. You would probably stand a chance of cracking your disc because the blade will try to outgrow the disc itself. So when you have that split of A286 versus 422, you end up not being able to move a stage three blade to stage two. So instead, what you'll end up having to do is make a new row two and a new row five, because you'll be able to move the row two to row one, but a three cannot replace a two in that movement. So it's only in certain circumstances that we recommend to customers to go to all A286 in an effort to save your blades. If you do elect to go from 422 in the last stages to A286, keep in mind that you will have to make new discs at that point out of A286 as well to match the material of the blade. So that's why we only recommend it to certain customers who are looking for new discs at that time. It's an option for them. And then finally, most of the machines nowadays are monitored, but if yours is not, we also offer installation of RTDs on your thrust pads, and as well installation of displacement probes for online monitoring and whatnot. So, and on the RTDs, we offer it both on the radial and the thrust pad. So take your pick as to which ones you want, mix and match, or all three if you would like. So with that, that was just a quick overview of all the improvements that we offer to our customers. These can be performed during any outage, or not any outage, but any routine maintenance. Just keep in mind of the long lead items. Some of these items, such as a case or a scroll, do take a fair amount of time to manufacture. We try and keep an inventory of some parts here, various parts, some discs, bearing housings and whatnot, blade, rotating blades as well. So if you have a need for one of these improvements or just general maintenance on these machines, feel free to call one of our salesmen. Also, if you have any questions for me or any more operational-based technical questions for Mark, please feel free to email me. My email is shown on this last page here.
Okay, thank you very much, Ash. We do have a question. I would like to actually ask about the project timeline. How long would it take to actually complete the whole process?
It will depend on the options that they want. It also depends on what parts are necessary to replace or manufacture new at that time. We won't know until it comes into our shop and we're able to do a full disassembly and inspection. New scrolls take a very long time, say 30 to 35 weeks to manufacture. So if you're looking to do this during a turnaround, it's probably not going to happen. If that was the case, we would have to order the scroll ahead of time. And leave stock here or there for final machining once your machine comes in. I don't know if you prefer actually doing that or in part ahead of time like that, a major component you need. So it really depends on what part they need. A new case would be upwards of a year delivery.
Okay, we have another question coming in. Is there any limitation to the condition of the expander that Sulzer can accept to make the improvement?
Sorry, can you repeat that again?
Yes. Is there any limitation to the condition of the expander that Sulzer can accept to make improvements?
Not necessarily, no. I mean, we've repaired some pretty banged up machines in the past. Any condition, really, we'd have to take a look at it and see what modifications we can or cannot do. For example, like the the brush shield will be one. It may or may not be advisable to go with the brush shield. It all depends on that customer's specific setup. So we work with our customers on an individual basis to determine what they really need.
Okay, we have one more question coming in. Now, what does Sulzer do to make sure the dowel pins on the scroll don't work loose or fall out?
Yeah, there are, this is Mark Bounds. They have, for all the inlet scroll pins or the stator pins, we have locking mechanisms that hold those in place so that they only have so much travel for thermal expansion inside the machine. But we have locking mechanisms that keep those from coming out of the out of place.
Okay, is there anything else you would like to add, Ash?
Not really. I mean, I hope the presentation made sense to everybody. Hopefully, it was helpful to people and educational. We've done a lot. We've been doing these modifications now for quite a while now, at least for the last 5-6 years. So we're very well versed in this machine. It's kind of our bread and butter. So if you have any other questions, feel free to email me, and I'll be happy to forward this your questions on either to Mark, or I'll answer them. If it's an engineering type question, sorry, but I won't be able to answer engineering questions anymore. I've actually moved out of the engineering group, moved on to the business.
Okay.
Contact with an engineer that I can reach on to help me answer any very technical questions.
Okay, I have one more quick question coming in before we wrap this up. How many E526s are there in service?
As of right now, I believe there's only 4 in service right now.
Okay, I think they heard that question. There was only about 4 in services at this time. Once again, I just want to say thank you so much, Ash Maruyama. Thank you so much for a great webinar and lots of great information. We appreciate it. And folks, once again, he's got his email up on the screen. You can email him if you've got any questions. This concludes today's webinar. I just want to say a very special thanks to Sulzer's Ash Maruyama, and a thank you to all of you for your interest. Thank you so much, and we hope you have a wonderful day.